Ham Radio Now, episode 45. I've got the title back here. It's a big one. I'm going to let Steve Bible read all that in a minute. Basically, it's about using ham radio to get information in an emergency from local communities out to the people who need to get it. It is one of the few non-technical talks from the Tapper Digital Communications Conference. And one thing I want to do, though, is look a little bit at the background of the person doing the presenting. It's Aleks Rohde, W3JAG. And they don't talk very much about this during the talk, so I pulled this up from the proceedings. She's a colonel, a former colonel and lawyer for the U.S. Army. Held lots of high-power positions, designed a 911 emergency system for Iraq, coined the phrase Homeland Security, and she's still licensed to practice law in D.C. and Illinois, and she's a ham and holds a top-secret clearance. So, very impressive lady, although the presentation that she's making tonight is from the perspective of a member of a ham radio club. And maybe a little bit more. So let's see what she's got to say about what you can do in your community and above with ham radio in an emergency. Aleks.
So continuing our talks this morning, I'd like to introduce Aleks, W3JAG. And she's going to speak about digital amateur radio in support of situational awareness, common operating picture, and community resilience.
How about that?
That's a mouthful.
Okay. Hi. Good morning. Thank you. I want to thank the conference organizers for allowing me to speak today because amateur radio is the center of gravity for emergency operations when all else fails. I've heard some fabulous presentations so far. I'm looking forward to more this afternoon. And listening to Chris KD2BMH's presentation, it reminds me of a concept in military called the revolution in military affairs. The idea that technological advances sometimes are so big that they fundamentally change the way organizations do business. And it is in amateur radio and thought-provoking forums like this Tapper conference that are the incubators for these revolutionary changes. So I'm very honored to be here. First, a little bit about my background. Years ago, I was a communications major at the University of Illinois and even got my first class FCC license. Then I was in graduate school in urban planning with an emphasis in community development. Studies at that time showed that residents in poor urban neighborhoods seldom ventured outside their own areas and felt isolated from the world outside. So for my thesis, I proposed a 10-watt community-based radio station so local residents could get the kind of targeted information they needed to help themselves and each other and feel less alienated. But then I went on to other things, and the 10-watt radio station idea kind of went by the wayside. But after all these years, the 10-watt radio station idea has been resurrected, but with a modern spin. Today I'm going to talk about a new paradigm in emergency communications that can hopefully increase situational awareness while simultaneously giving the local communities the tools they need to successfully adapt and survive during a disaster. This new paradigm in emergency communications can be summarized, I think, in two thoughts. Let me see, try this new technology. There. What we don't know can hurt us, and we're all in this together. Okay, so let's talk about first what we don't know and how it can hurt us. An earthquake and tsunami swept over Japan in March 11, 2011, leaving 28,000 either dead or missing. Residents of one coastal village ran up a hillside to escape the tidal wave. Unfortunately, what they didn't know was that the tidal wave was higher than the hill, and they were all washed away. Okay. Hurricane Katrina was one of the deadliest and costliest natural disasters in U.S. history. It killed more than 1,800 people and caused about $81 billion in property damage. In New Orleans, in what has been called a catastrophic engineering failure, the storm surge pushed its water over the tops of nearly every levee in the city, killing 700 people. First responders were at a loss because they had no actionable intelligence of the situation during those critical hours as the levees were failing and the floodwaters were rising. Because of the massive scope of the devastation, federal assets were stretched, and the search for the missing was therefore relegated to local authorities, with their limited resources going door to door. As a result, the search for the missing went on for months. By October of that year, 700 bodies had been recovered, and to this day, 135 people are still missing. Okay. This past June, a little closer to home, a violent series of thunderstorms called the derecho struck my local tri-state area of DC, Virginia, and Maryland. It toppled thousands of trees and power lines. At least five people were killed, with three heat-related deaths in Maryland alone. Internet and cell phone service was disrupted, and over 1.25 million people were left without power for up to 1 week. The storm also knocked out Northern Virginia's 911 system for the entire weekend. So residents in that area couldn't even call for help. However, amateur radio operators stayed connected, advising each other on such mundane things, but important things like where to find an open grocery store or a gas station that took cash because the ATM machines don't work without power. Especially troubling, one older ham asked if anyone knew where he and his wife might find an open cooling shelter, because without power, the record-breaking heat in June was particularly dangerous to the old and the frail. The amateur radio community stayed in contact, helping each other, but others outside this close community didn't have the same system of support. Okay, over half of the American population lives within 50 miles of a coast, and 14 of the world's 17 largest cities are located along a coastline. Seattle, Los Angeles, and San Francisco are all built on major earthquake fault lines. By statistical averages, Los Angeles is overdue for the next big one. With an estimated population of 37 million people in Southern California, a major disaster could kill between 2,000 and 50,000 people and cause billions of dollars in damages. NASA funded a study in 2009 that forecast a 12% probability that a catastrophic solar storm would hit the Earth in the next 10 years. Many in government, including the Department of Defense, are looking closely at the possible consequences. We don't know what will happen, but if it is powerful enough, it could significantly damage our power grids, GPS, and satellite communications. In our highly technical society, this could mean the inability to provide even basic provisions of food, water, and fuel for days, months, or even years before full recovery. A friend of mine attended a Department of Defense briefing on the subject a couple of months ago and came back pretty shaken by it. I asked her what she would do to prepare, and she said, "I'm getting more ammo." I think there's another option. We need to get better emergency communications into the hands of private citizens so they can help each other and also integrate that community communications network with the first responders through ham radio operators so that they can keep each other informed even as a crisis unfolds. The Department of Homeland Security has highlighted core capabilities it believes are necessary to effectively respond to emergencies. These include situational awareness, a common operating picture, and resilient communities. So let's take a look at these three. According to the National Response Framework published by the Department of Homeland Security, situational awareness is the first requirement in an effective response plan. You need to have the right information at the right time to make the right decisions and take the right actions. Situational awareness is also the toughest thing to achieve, especially in the first moments before disaster strikes and the first hours afterwards. Time is of the essence in the first moments before a disaster to warn people and instruct them on life-saving measures, such as seeking shelter or climbing high enough to avoid rising water. In the first hours after a disaster strikes, when people are dying and buildings are burning, every minute counts. But it is this critical time period that first responders, the police, fire, and emergency medical teams typically have the least amount of information on which to act, causing needless delays in which more lives might be lost. Of course, the residents in a stricken area know immediately what's happening to them and their neighbors. They can see the water rising, they can see the buildings burning or the trees falling, and they need to be connected to each other and to the first responders to get this real-time actionable intelligence to the places it can do the most good, to each other and especially to the first responders. Building situational awareness is, however, only the first step. While detailed information of a crisis as it unfolds is critical, it can quickly turn into information overload, overwhelming decision makers and resulting in wrong or delayed decisions at critical junctures. Therefore, to avoid information overload and needless delays, the vast amount of information received needs to be consolidated into an effective real-time decision-making tool called the Common Operating Picture. If anybody's ever been to Gettysburg Battlefield, that's the old electric map. And it was a way they took visitors and described the three-day battle succinctly. So there was lights that lit up for the Confederate forces, lights that went up for the Union forces, and it was on this topography that made everything understandable. So that's this kind of a simple schematic. The Common Operating Picture takes the information collected for situational awareness, filters it, makes computations as necessary, and presents the resulting findings in an intuitive format mutually shared by first responders, government officials, and private citizens in the local communities. The information could also include things like topography and atmospheric conditions, GPS locations of citizens and first responders, priorities of response activities as they develop, including resources required and where they are available. It also needs to be accessible in a mobile format for real-time response. Collecting information for situational awareness and developing a common operating picture through an integrated approach with the active participation of private citizens ultimately results in community resilience. A resilient community is not a strong community so much as it's a community that can successfully adapt to changed circumstances. A community like New Orleans can be fundamentally changed by a disaster, but it can successfully adapt to those changes if its community are given the kinds of tools that help it to do that. As Katrina illustrates, even the most extensive government resources aren't always enough. And neighbors inside their communities are really the first responders. And we need to take advantage of this force multiplier. Because the chances are that the first person that knocks on your door during a disaster is not going to be the police or the fire, it's going to be your neighbor asking if you're okay. They will know before outside rescue teams how a disaster has affected their neighborhood. Ongoing two-way communications within the communities and between the communities and the first responders are vital for achieving real-time situational awareness, a common operating picture that provides true actionable intelligence and ultimately results in a resilient community that successfully adapts even when disaster strikes. In addition to the work being funded by the Department of Homeland Security, there is congressional interest to support research and development into innovations in emergency communications, including broadband radio and the 911 system. House Bill 607 and Senate Bill 1040 provide authority and funding to develop a, quote, wireless public safety broadband network for first responders that is interoperable and disaster survivable, either connected to the internet or through local networks. Senate Bill 911 provides for resources to build a nationwide interoperable wireless public safety broadband network and also encourages advanced research and development into emerging wireless technologies. So, what does this new paradigm in emergency communications look like? Well, it comes in two parts. Part one is connecting a community's citizens to each other for mutual aid and support by developing a local area emergency communications network. I'm also with Montgomery County Amateur Radio Club with Dave W2LNX, And we're working parts of this now, and we're looking at part one as connecting the community citizens to each other for mutual aid and support by developing a local area emergency communications network. We would optimally like to leverage equipment that is already in the communities and not necessarily limited to radios and routers. Depending on the regional environmental risks, the network would optimally also include advanced meteorological, geological, chemical, and biological sensors and trackers that could help monitor environmental factors as well as locate individuals. Part two is connecting the local emergency communications network to outside the disaster area to the rescue personnel through a longer distance communication capability on a ham frequency. It will bring real-time information flow between the local citizens and outside responders to keep each other informed with real-time actionable intelligence, especially in the first critical moments and hours of a disaster, saving more lives in the process. Our group is currently testing the long-distance portion of the emergency communications network and has successfully tested wireless broadband radio that can transmit up to 50 miles on 420 megahertz on a half watt of power. David W2LNX Byrne is the brainchild for this portion of the effort, and you saw his great presentation this morning. We believe that utilizing the amateur radio frequencies, in addition to its mission of emergency communications, it's the obvious choice in addition to the mission, but also because these frequencies are dedicated to emergency communications and therefore aren't vulnerable to overcrowding of airwaves during an emergency situation, which is, of course, what happens with cell phones and landlines. Because we are using a UHF frequency, antenna size is not as much of an issue and therefore not as vulnerable to damage during a disaster. And of course, low power radio can continue operating using low power sources such as solar or battery, even when traditional sources of power are lost. Oops, take that back one. There. Okay. To ensure the development of equipment and business rules that truly work in a disaster scenario, we articulated some basic planning assumptions to better inform our decision-making process and ensure that our solutions address the full range of possible challenges during a disaster. So here we've identified this list so far. So in addition to, in a disaster, odds are there's not going to be any power, internet or cell service, so at least don't plan on it. Every minute counts when lives are at stake, so whatever we develop has to be real-time and accessible to all who need it. The disaster is going to happen in someone's community, in someone's backyard, and those community's neighbors will know before anyone else what the ground truth is in that disaster at that moment. So these neighbors need good communications integrated with each other and the first responders. Okay, in these times of fiscal constraints, there are limited financial resources both at the national and the local community levels. So whatever we come up with has to be already in the community or extremely cheap and easy to acquire ahead of time. And then finally, there's limited technical expertise within the community. So whatever we develop has to be really easy to use. So applying this list of assumptions, we identified capabilities necessary for equipment and processes to be relevant and effective in a disaster operation. And you'll see our initial list of capabilities are across the top on the blue bar. And on the side, we're really equipment agnostic at this time, but we just kind of listed those things that we thought of so far. And I've saw some excellent presentations that I talked to the people about these types of capabilities and equipment that can deliver those capabilities. So real-time information flow, integration of local communities, quick and easy installation, those kinds of things. And we're going to use this table to do a gap analysis. So we're going to assess the different types of equipment candidates against the necessary capabilities and then do it in two parts. So whatever's feasible in the near term for a solution as well as the more ideal long-term innovations. Some of the gap analysis is going to be based on original experimentation, and some is going to be a review of the literature of other developers' experiences, like at this wonderful forum. For example, the details in the Oklahoma City experience with packet radios versus broadband radio. to provided for us a detailed start point for consideration of first responder communications requirements, such as the need for photos, input fingerprints, file reports, and access to public safety databases while out in the field. We have two videos posted on YouTube of our ongoing experimentation with low-power, long-distance transmission of broadband video and data. David, too, LNX, again, is the brainchild for this work. If you go to YouTube and you put and you type in W3JAG or W2LNX in the search box at the YouTube site, you'll come up with the videos. The next phase of our work is the community-level communications. In addition to selecting equipment for testing, we're talking to some nearby communities to help us experiment. In this way, we can work through not only the equipment, but also the business rules for how this would come together at the community level. And in geographic regions that are particularly fragile or prone to dangerous conditions, we are looking at integrating alert sensors and trackers tailored to these regional risks. I got an email from a gentleman in Vietnam who saw our YouTube videos. He wrote asking if we could test our equipment in his country. He is very concerned because of the natural geography of Vietnam, with its long coastline open to the sea, making it a target for tsunamis. Also, the lower Mekong Delta is prone to flooding. But most distressing from his communications is the central part of the country. According to this man, hydropower plants have been built on the rivers, which are at junctions of tectonic plates. The power plants put a lot of pressure on these plates, and it's causing earthquakes. He writes, quote, "These issues are really dangerous, as the villagers around are now really worried when they feel the earthquake. Moreover, these hydropower plants are built with real bad quality and bad design. At the moment, I do think there will be a big disaster for the villagers around these areas without any preparation. In those dangerous areas, I think we can utilize your equipment as experiments to save human lives." The presentations at this conference have addressed many of the technologies that would be extremely applicable to our work, such as the APRS YAC, which could be decoupled from the internet and form the basis of a common operating picture. Other presentations were especially intriguing for their work with mesh networks and situational awareness. We hope to link up with these innovative thinkers and to help us with our work. Anyway, there's much work to be done and many people that can be helped if we get this right. Thank you for your time.
Hi, Colonel Rohde, thank you for your talk. Do you think there's room for cognition in these devices so that we can identify what the local radios are, so that we can interoperate with them and maybe help them out in providing backhaul communications? Because if we don't interconnect with the locals' radios, we won't be able to help them much.
Right, right.
And thanks for not presenting quad charts.
military.
Military.
I get it. Right. There's a lot of things we're thinking through because obviously, you know, the local citizens, we can't expect them to be ham operators. So whatever they use, I know that there was one community that came to us and they asked for our help in getting their community some sort of communications for emergencies. And one of our members suggested FRS, just plain old walkie-talkies. And so I'm not the technical person, and I'm going to say that that's David W2LNX, but the little bit that I looked up, the GMRS and the FRSs, there's a little more promise in them because some of them come with GPS locators on them, which is very good. They can link up to each other and form like an easy, cheap way to communicate. It's not the only solution, but it's something we've thought about up front. The key is how to integrate that. And if you have cell phone service, how to integrate cell phone service into the ham radio communications network. So and then have that connect up to the first responders. I had a little bit of this experience when I was in Iraq back in 2003. I was a military assistant for the Ministry of Interior, and so I was in charge of developing a communications network, 911 first responder network for Iraq. And a lot of these issues came up because the rules for operation for the police during, before 2003, during the Saddam era, it was the police never left the police station. You had to come to the police, if anybody, I'm sure there's people here that have been there and know this. If a citizen had a problem, they had to go to the police station. They couldn't, you know, there were no cell phones during Saddam's era, so you had to get in your car or you had to walk there. And if you're being attacked or you're being robbed, the last thing you can do is get up and walk to the police station. So we wanted to make it easier for citizens to interact with the police, so the police knew what was going on. So in addition to, and this was the Motorola people and the, and we had an in-house communications person that helped us look at, and the space people from the Army National Guard. We had a map of Iraq. We knew where all the fiber optics were because it's a pretty modern country. There was a lot of fiber optics running through there that we could leverage. And then we set up these regional hubs for operations, and then the central operations center would be in Baghdad. And it's that same kind of thinking that you have to go through. So what are going to be your regions, and what's going to be the central operating point? Because not everybody can call simultaneously because you have the same problems over again. So then you've got to devise talk groups, right? So inside your community, you're going to have about 10 to 15 people in these walkie-talkie talk groups. So those are the kinds of rules I think that you're talking about, is how is that all going to work? And then everybody was getting cell phones. So how am I going to integrate the cell phones with the first responder police band radios to make them all work? And what are the rules of the road going to be? You know, who is designated inside the community as the block captain, maybe? You know, so I go to the block captain comes to the police station. That kind of thinking has to be worked through. We're not sure exactly how that looks yet, but it's got to happen. So thank you very much for that question. Thank you.
So thanks for the presentation. I was curious, is there a broken down list of use cases for emergency communications? For example, there's citizens who just need to communicate with their neighbors, there's mm-hmm. hospitals, there's, so what are the different types of needs in this environment, and how does that work?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. That's on our to-do list because that's one of the things we've got. In fact, I know that came up a couple of weeks ago. We went to the city of Tacoma because we helped support their July 4th parade. And we tried to talk them into using our mesh network equipment, and they didn't want it because it was something new and different, and they didn't know how they would use it. Right? Well, what am I going to do with this? So then afterwards, we went to a meeting with the citizens, kind of the leaders of that community. And we try to again sell them on the idea of helping us with this emergency communications network. And they said, well, how are we going to use this, right? So what we need to do is sell them on the idea of, like, it's not just about emergency communications. It's communications within your community to do certain things. So what are those things that they could really use, right? I mean, what, I don't want to make them do stuff that they don't want to naturally learn about because they naturally need it, right? If there isn't a pull for that information, it's useless. It's going to sit on a shelf. Yeah, good point. Thank you.
Back to FRS. In our area, we always recommend the ham radios can be the extra boots on the ground, and that is, we recommend everybody bring an FRS radio to your ham radio event and just have it on a channel. That way you can tell other people, you know, if you're not a ham and you need to contact somebody, just call on this channel, and now the hams can then be that the boots on the ground to get that information back to ELC. And they have a built-in filter. You know, as communicators, they kind of know what's important, what's not important, and everything else, mm-hmm. rather than just having everybody coming in on channel 9 to the EOC where they're overloaded.
Right. No, good point. Thank you.
Yeah, Alex and I have been talking about this the last couple of months, and the question is interoperability. There's been some progress with the public service radios at the state level or at the county level, but when you go from state to federal, it's the same problem all over again, but a higher level. So I asked myself, what's a common denominator that everybody understands? And I realized, imagine if all radios talk a common language, look sneakingly suspicious like TCP/IP. So once you have TCP/IP, then you could do everything off the shelf, you know. Anyway, that's just a comment, just a food for thought.
It seems to me there are a number of what I'll call sociological issues mm-hmm. regarding maintenance in various locales where people have a different sense of the values regarding taking care of this stuff or leaving it alone, at the risk of sounding like Romney. But How do you address that? I mean, obviously there's got to be some sort of ongoing maintenance, upkeep, let's make sure all these things are working, and an educational thing to show as many people as possible that this is a valuable asset and it's in their own interest.
Right. That's an excellent point. I've been trying to find the belly button for how to get into the integration between government and the community. Because, in fact, I took the training for the EOC. I'm in the training for the CERT, in Community Emergency Response Teams. And I'm not finding where, this seems to be a natural kind of a conclusion to come to is you're not going to know anything until you integrate the citizens into your emergency response plan. It just seems like a no-da. But how do we do that? That's a really good question, because right now, government officials, I got the ball, right? You know, if it's not invented in my backyard, I don't want to hear about it, right? And then the private citizens don't know what they don't know. Like when we went to this meeting a couple of weeks ago, the person that was leading our team, I mean, I love the guy, but he said to the citizens, figure out what you want and then come talk to us. And that's exactly backwards. You know, we've got to come to them with kind of an explanation. We've got to grow this together where they say, oh, I get it. I see where you're going with this. And can you also do these kinds of things to help me? And that's when all the barriers break down and all of a sudden you're working together. We're not there yet, though. Yeah.
So maybe not a question so much as maybe we need to talk. But a little background on the Huntsville-Madison County area, mm-hmm. Which is very close here to Georgia. And our main threats here are severe weather. And when the tornadoes hit a year and a half ago, there was loss of life, and it was a tremendous cleanup effort. Our Ares RACES group is extremely well integrated with the local EOC, and we also have a really good connection to the state. We knew that was valuable, and we knew that would be useful during any unanticipated emergency. What we didn't realize is that the committee liaisons we had to VOAD and to the CERT group and all these other teams would be the connection that we needed to expand into these things that we didn't anticipate. Hmm. And so as an example, exactly talking about deployment, mm-hmm. the CERT people and the people in the community didn't require any upkeep or equipment. Most of the knowledge base resided in that team that works with the volunteers. When we fielded the cleanup efforts, the way it turned out was, okay, now we've got 1,000 volunteers and we have to manage those and make sure no one gets hurt. Mm-hmm. We need some people that are sort of basically trained. We've got a handful of really good field operators in the amateur community, but we need a lot more than that. What we ended up doing was fielding the CERT team members as crew chiefs, which is not something they're really trained to do, but they had more than zero training. And it was a fabulous use of resources, and we fielded them with FRS radios with one ham on each team. Mm-hmm. And so that sort of flexibility, that was arrived at overnight, that sort of flexibility and a knowledge of what capabilities exist was really valuable, and that resided in the Ares RACES EOC circle and was able to be deployed.
I mean, what we're talking about here, and I think it's excellent, is what you develop is kind of an operating plan. Right, you figured out what role everybody would have. It's just like when the military goes to war, right? You've got units. Those units have special purposes. They have special equipment depending on their purposes. And what we need to do is figure out some sort of an operational plan. And it wouldn't be one size fits all. And places like yours would be case studies of how it works.
Exactly, and even more than having a plan, because you know from the military, you can't plan for everything.
No.
But what you can do is have a core set of people who at least have an exhaustive understanding of the resources available and how they can be deployed, and then try to make some reasonable decisions in situations that were unanticipated.
So. No, that's excellent. That's excellent. In fact, in my agreeing with you on this is in my experience with the CERT teams is anybody that wants to can be a member, right? So you can go and go for the training. But there's no thought about getting those people to represent communities, so they're dispersed geographically, right? I mean, wouldn't that be a kind of useful. So I would be the representative for my little neighborhood in Silver Spring. Someone else would be, so those guys disperse back into their communities, and they're in charge of taking care of their communities with the training that you get in the CERT, that kind of thing you're talking about.
Right, and what we did with the CERT team members that it wasn't anticipated, that's mm-hmm. the CERT model. What we did was we asked for them, because the reality of the tornado aftermath was mm-hmm. there were two communities that were devastated, mm. and the rest of the county, we've got a county population of over a third of a million people, was relatively unaffected. So we were able to take that dispersed resource of CERT team members and ask them voluntarily if they'd like to be deployed into the disaster areas, and that worked out very well for us.
Thank you. Could we talk afterwards? And I think that we could use your...
Yeah, I'd be happy to.
...your experience. Yeah. Thank you.
I think the gentleman in the back said the right word, sociological. Or the question is, the issue is, the problem is, the human beings, well, you know, they live in a world where everything is fine, and it's not going to happen to them. There is this belief system that they're invincible, they're immortal, and they want to just wake up and have a good time, you know, just enjoy life. So how do you help people overcome the inertia to do some minimal preparation? That's an interesting ringtone. And I have to confess, I'm a typical pigeon. I'm an example of that. It's like on my to-do list for the last 10 years is improve my emergency communications. I need to get more batteries. I need to have, maybe I should have more than 6 cans of food. Maybe I should have water. Actually, water I have around because I like clean water, filtered water. So, so how do you help people overcome the inertia about preparation? And I suspect as a group fun activity, a community activity, a family activity, we would do it together. It's a lot more fun than, okay, which generator should I shop? Maybe I don't. Tomorrow. It's up to human nature, myself included, is to defer the unpleasant things for tomorrow, and then tomorrow comes and the tornado strikes. So that's a major personal and social issue.
I just want to make a comment on that. Sometimes paradigms don't change until disaster strikes. I was on a team. I was a facilitator for a team because I'm retired out of the Army National Guard. And I was a facilitator on a team where the lead lead of the team was General Courtright from Oklahoma. And this was just a couple of years after the Murrow Building bombing, where I forget his name, Terry, the person that drove that truck in front of the building and knocked out half of it. Remember that? Yeah. So he was very sensitive to natural disasters on domestic soil. And so we started this team. We started talking things out about what can the National Guard do, right? It's the same kind of operational planning. What do I bring to the party, and what can I do? And so we decided armories. Armories are in 3,300 communities across the United States, so they're naturally geographically dispersed. So when the police car drives up to the Murrow Building, or the fire crew drives up to the Murrow Building, and that thing is huge, you go, oh my God, too big for me. So what's the police 911? Who do they call for backup? And so we thought National Guard would be the ideal choice because of their ability to command, control, coordinate all the assets. So this was that thinking. So we took it on the road, we're pitching it, and we went to some seminars, and I had an FBI agent actually stick his finger in my chest and say, there is no problem here in the United States. This was back in 1999, 2 years before 2001, right. He goes, we have no risks here, and there is no terrorism threat. And then he was very upset, and he said, we're going to give you guys some money, but only because it's just to, keep you, away pretty much. And so that paradigm didn't change until 9/11. So that's unfortunately what happens sometimes. So all you can do is prepare, get your equipment ready, and hope to God there is no other 9/11. But if there is, you're going to be prepared. Thank you. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so now the challenge is for all you techies out there, now you have an application, right?